They can cause jaw pain, skin issues, unexpected injuries, and even emergency surgeries. They're your organs, and they can be a pain. But at least they're working hard to keep you alive, right? Not exactly. The human body has a surprising number of vestigial organs, body parts left over from an earlier point in evolution that no longer serve a purpose. Here are some of those organs and body parts that really aren't pulling their weight anymore. Let's start with one that's most obvious in babies. Have you ever touched a little baby's palm, only to be surprised when the baby immediately tightens its grip on your finger? It's weird that this is one of the first controlled motions the baby exhibits, or so it seems. It's actually a reflex, stimulated by tendons in the palm, and it can even be seen in utero as early as 16 weeks into gestation. It continues until the baby starts developing fine motor skills several months after being born. So, why is this such a key reflex for infants? Biologists have been studying it for a while and believed it originated in primate species with more fur, like chimpanzees. The reflex allows the infant to grip onto the mother's fur without being directly carried, so the mom can forage. The hunter-gatherer lifestyle is mostly gone for humans, and mom is more likely to carry the baby in a stroller these days, so all this reflex does is make it easier for the baby to grab onto your hair. This next vestigial trait is the bane of teenagers everywhere. Normally, teeth can be a good thing. You keep them clean, and in exchange, they let you tear into some corn on the cob. But some teeth are more trouble than they're worth. The wisdom teeth are the last teeth to emerge, usually coming in during the teen years and early adulthood. Most people have four of them, but some have fewer or none. When they come out, there can be trouble. They can be impacted, cause pain and infections, and if they do emerge, they can crowd other teeth and be hard to clean. More often than not, wisdom teeth get pulled. So why does our jaw even bother? Wisdom teeth are large, powerful molars, and in the old days, having more molars was helpful. After all, the average primordial human diet consisted of raw meat and tough, fibrous plants. You needed some power to rip through those. Now you don't really need that jaw force to get through your Big Mac and fries. Not only are the wisdom teeth less necessary, but the average size of the human jaw has shrunk, meaning no room for them to come in comfortably. For this next vestigial organ, it's all in the wrist. Try touching the pads of your fourth finger and thumb. Does a line appear when you flex your wrist? If so, you're only one of roughly 85% of humans who still have the palmaris longus muscle. This body part is so useless that a lot of people have evolved out of having it altogether, and those who do have it won't get much use out of it. While it can be found in many of our common relatives like gorillas and chimpanzees, they also don't seem to have much use for it. So is it actually good for anything? Biologists suspect that it was used more before opposable thumbs evolved in the primate world, and it just kinda stuck around since then. The only difference between those who have it and those who don't is that those without it have slightly lower pinch strength, but the effect is so minor that it's frequently removed and used in those who need tendon grafts in another part of their body. This next one might just give you goosebumps. The body has a lot of different muscles, but these are among the smallest in the human body. They are the erector pili muscles, and they control the movement of the hair follicles, and that means they can make your hair stand on end. They are most commonly reflected in goosebumps, those weird little skin bumps that you get when you're too cold or too nervous about something. So these muscles are definitely still working, but they're not all that helpful, and can be more annoying than anything. But in other animals, it's a very different story. Humans don't have too much body hair, so there isn't much for the erector pili muscles to do, but in animals with a much thicker fur coating, having their hair stand on end can be helpful. If they're moving into a tight space, their hair extending can help warn them of danger before it hits their skin, and if they're trying to scare an enemy or impress a potential mate, they can puff out their hair to look more impressive. Now that might be useful when that one guy cuts in line at the coffee shop, but alas, humans aren't built that way. And it's not the only area of the body where animals have the edge on us. Have you ever watched your cat or a dog when they notice something? One of the first things that happens is their ears start twitching toward the source of the noise. It's cute, and should immediately be posted on YouTube. But it's also useful to them as they can point their ears toward the source of their surprise and hear better. They use the tiny muscles called the auricular muscles to manipulate their ears, and humans have three of these muscles too. Our versions are much less useful. Two of the three auricular muscles in humans are pretty useless, but one, the anterior auricular muscle, has a subtle effect. It can draw part of the upper ear up and forward. The human ear has evolved to provide a pretty good listening experience regardless of where you're standing, so we don't need to shift our ears with these muscles. However, being able to wiggle your ears is a pretty good party trick. This next organ is either the stuff of life or just some extra skin. It's one thing virtually all mammals have in common, nipples. In female mammals, they're attached to breast tissue that provides vital milk for their young. Some animals have long rows of nipples, but humans only have two, and all humans have two, even though men don't really seem to need them. Male nipples are usually flat, not attached to milk-producing organs, and seem to provide no evolutionary purpose. So why haven't they been eliminated by evolution yet? Some schoolyard bullies would probably say because to do so would eliminate the purple nurple, but scientists sent them to detention and provided an alternative theory. Males and females start from the same genetic base, and the founding foundation of the nipples and the fetus actually comes before the point in development where it's determined whether the future baby will be a boy or a girl. These remnants of fetal development don't provide a vital function, but they do hold a bundle of sensitive nerves that can cause arousal. A lot of vestigial organs are about protection, even when it's not needed anymore. It's a weird little quirk of the eyes. What's that little lump of tissue in the corner where it meets your nose? Not only does it seem to not fulfill any purpose, but it's one of the first places in the eye to get irritated by allergies or smoke. The only use it seems to have is making your eyes water more and to make it more obvious when your eyes are getting red. In animals, though, it's a very different story. Are you ready to meet your third eyelid? Humans have two eyelids, the more flexible top one and the protective bottom one. But many animals, including birds and reptiles, have a third layer called the nictitating membrane that can be drawn over the eye for extra protection. Few mammals still have it, but they do have the base it evolved from, that little corner of eye tissue. Only one primate, a small loris from the rainforests of West Africa, still kept this unique eye feature functional. Some organs come from a much older primal time. The human body has a number of sense organs that control our senses of sight, hearing, touch, smell, and taste. But one smell organ isn't what it used to be. Jacobson's organ, or the vomeronasal organ, is a tiny organ located in the nasal cavity and can be found in all snakes and lizards. Some mammals, like dogs, cats, and pigs, have it too, and humans often have a vestigial organ based on it. But don't get too excited, it's not good for much. Wait, why do the animals get all the secret smells? Jacobson's organ is designed to detect specific chemical compounds, particularly those coming from predators and prey. It's also useful for detecting sex pheromones from potential mates. In other words, it's useful for wild animals who live their lives by primal functions of hunting, being hunted, and looking to reproduce. Humans haven't been living that way for a very long time, and so this organ is out of work. Just because an organ isn't useful doesn't mean it can't be painful. It takes up much of the lower legs and can be the bane of runners everywhere, the plantaris muscle. This long, superficial muscle is the longest tendon in the human body and runs all the way from the knee joint to the heel. And for all that length, its function is weak flexion of the ankle joint and the knee. It might also help the central nervous system perceive where the foot is positioned, but its overall function to the body is minimal, so it may cause more trouble than it's worth. The plantaris muscle is susceptible to injury caused by too much pressure on one leg. Tennis, basketball, and soccer players often suffer ruptures that can take some time to heal. Although the injury to the muscle doesn't cause long-term damage to physical ability that tearing other tendons or muscles can. The tendon can be removed and used for tendon transplants, and scientists believe it's more useful in other primates who commonly grip things with their feet. This next organ might be funny to say, but it's not essential for life. Spleen! This organ resembles a large lymph node and mostly works as a blood filter. Its name comes from ancient Greece, and it removes old red blood cells, stores blood, and recycles iron into the blood. It also provides a home for lymphocytes packed with antibodies, which boost the immune system. It's a helpful organ and can be found in all vertebrates, but it's also delicate. So, what happens if something goes wrong? The spleen is prone to rupture when injured and usually has to be removed. Immune system disorders can also affect the spleen's function, and if that happens, don't worry, the body has you covered. There can be some deficits in the immune system as a result, but the liver takes over most of the spleen's function. People without a spleen can live a long, healthy life and probably have to deal with chuckles when they tell people which organ they're missing. But it's more useful than this next organ. It's all in the name. The appendix. It's a small tube attached near the colon, and it's one of the most common causes of early childhood surgeries. If the appendix gets inflamed or infected, it can cause severe stomach pains. If left untreated, it can burst, a life-threatening condition that sends dangerous bacteria through the body. Today, the appendix can be removed safely and quickly, but in the past, it was a common cause of death. And for all that trouble, what does the appendix actually do? Well, for a long time, people thought the answer was nothing. It was just a random body part that didn't help until it randomly tried to kill you. Today, scientists believe nothing is without its purpose, and the appendix is essentially a storage tube packed with beneficial gut bacteria that help your digestive health. It's useful, but not necessary. Millions of people have had their appendix removed, and none of them seem to have any long-term health issues. Finally, here's something that's a remnant of a much older time, the tailbone, or coccyx, probably the most annoying bone in the body, the last part of the vertebral column in apes and humans. It's a pointy bone that you don't usually notice until you fall on it the wrong way. Then it reminds you of its existence with a painful jolt. If fractured, it can cause difficulty walking for a long time and force you to wander around with a donut-shaped cushion to sit on. Awkward. But ages ago, it served a very different purpose. The coccyx is a short, stubby thing in humans today, but in our ancestors it was longer, a lot longer. The coccyx is our vestigial tail, the last trace of when we were swinging around in the trees and using our tails to hold on to branches. Today it's mostly useless, although it does provide attachments to various other muscles and tendons in the area. But it's a far cry from its former self. It would be kind of useful to have a tail you could hold a cup of coffee with. For more on this strange body we inhabit, check out 20 Things Your Body Does That We Don't Know Why, or watch this other video instead.